So continue to comfort and bless us and give us your peace and encouragement. And as we wait for that joyful place in our hearts, Lord, when you come and reveal yourself to us, help us to wait patiently and expectantly as we experience that joy in our lives. And all God's people say, amen.
The dead be raised in the here and now. The loving made in the church live loud. Our God will save, we believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. The loving may let the church live loud. Our God will save. We believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail. For the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. And He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And He's coming back again. We believe.
Oh. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel.
In the beginning was the Word, spoken and breathed, a promise made and kept.
Keep the faith, God's promise is true.
The Word was in the beginning, and through him all things come into being.
Keep going. Persevere in joy, giving voice to God's presence yet again.
Thank you.
So glad that you are here today. Awesome, 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 awesome. How many of you know what this word says? Oh, I see one person. That's right, another person. Tell me all at the same time. It says
joy.
Joy, exactly, exactly. We love it. Yep, that's great. That's great. Show me what joy looks like. All of that is joy, isn't it? Yes, you did very well on that. Now, I have another question. Do you know any songs that are about joy? About joy and Christmas, too. Could be yes. Okay. Sometimes bands play songs about joy, and the band up front will play songs about joy for us as well. Have you ever heard Joy to the World? Yeah, that's right. That's a Christmas song, isn't it? And it's about joy. Uh-huh. Emery said that her school is doing a program, and there might be some solos, and if it might be her, she might get stage fright, and we can all understand that. Yes, can't we? So joy is like dancing and singing and having a wonderful time, and Joy to the World is one. You know another one? You can even call Santa. Oh, that's exciting. So Santa is joyful. Do you know that song? Jingle Bells is a joyful song, yep. Yeah. How many of you know, and congregation, I'm going to get you to help us with this. How many of you know the song, I've Got the Joy, 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 Joy? All right. Look at all these folks who know it. Well, let's sing it, okay? Okay, here we go. Thank you. Put it down a little lower for you. Jesus, thank you for joy. Thank you for loving us so that we can put that joy in our hearts. Amen. God bless you.
Jesus loves the little children. Brown, yellow, black, and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Thank you, praise band. Thank you, congregation. You guys sound great. We're always welcoming more people up here, so if you know. You sounded great. You passed the test, right? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. That is the test. Hey, things are different up here. Did you notice? Did you notice? Look, I have room, and I can see you, and I'm not using a music stand. I'm so excited. I will be honest that this is for the children's play this afternoon. But I got jealous and said, can we keep it? So we're going to try it out and see what happens. I'm really kind of excited. By the way, the children's play is at 3 this afternoon, and you are all welcome to come and watch their joy this afternoon. It'll be great. Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Now, when Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and proclaim his message in their cities. When John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, The lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me. As they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. What did you go out into the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal palaces. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written. See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you. Truly, I tell you, among those born of women, no one has arisen greater than John the Baptist. Yet the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You might have to excuse me a little bit today. I have finally succumbed to the crud. And so I'm going to keep my drink handy so that I can continue to get through the morning. And I will attempt to not share my germs with you. So if I don't hug or shake your hand, that's why. So today we continue our sermon series on expect. And the first Sunday was expect the light. And last week we expected new growth. And this Sunday we're expecting the unexpected. Expect the unexpected. Are there any Big Brother fans out here? No? Okay, you don't have to raise your hand. I know that it's a little like a soap opera, right? It's a guilty pleasure in my house. We watch it. And one of their catch lines is expect the unexpected. And I couldn't help but think of that all week as I was preparing for this sermon. But I digress. This morning in our gospel from Matthew, we hear the fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy. One who has come to save the Hebrew people. John the Baptist has done his part. He pointed people to Jesus and now finds himself in Herod's prison at the end of his life. He was desperate and needing reassurance that Jesus was indeed the one who is to come. Perhaps he is thinking that this Messiah is not working quite fast enough. You know, and who could blame him? He's sitting in prison, right? Sitting in prison for doing what he was supposed to do for this Messiah, who is supposedly Jesus. So where is the Messiah to save him? Jesus receives the question from John's disciples and answers it by pointing to the work of God in the land. The blind see, the crippled walk, skin diseases are cleansed, the deaf hear, while the dead are raised and the poor receive the good news. Jesus is fulfilling his promises found in Isaiah 35 and 61. But John is not getting liberated. Not going to happen. His fate is sealed. But there are signs everywhere that the realm of God is present. Jesus wants to assure John that he is the one. Despite appearances, he should not give up hope. I'm not sure that this word would have resolved all of John's concerns. If we were in his position, we might be wondering about our own situation. The other striking thing about Jesus' answer to John is that it carries no judgment or condemnation. It simply offers the truth in black and white. Excuse me. Jesus points to the evidence of his own ministry to say that he is, in fact, the one to come. And then as John's disciples turn away, Jesus commends John to the crowd. He bears witness to John's ministry and validates it. Maybe you've experienced this in your own life. A colleague whom you work with validates your work to someone else to build you up. The person didn't have to sing your praises to another coworker or even your boss, but they did. And how did that make you feel? It's that little warm, fuzzy feeling, right? Somebody sees me. Somebody cares about what I do. I know when I hear from some other United Methodists across the connection that someone from here is out telling good things that are happening, that I get that warm, fuzzy feeling about our church. It's the good kind of pride, right? How could you not? Jesus is providing irrefutable evidence that John's ministry was valid. I was a high school senior, just graduated. I was 18 when my parents took me on one of those group student trips to Europe. And I was so excited because I had traveled to Europe in textbooks and in fictional books, and so I was so excited that I was going to get to see all of these things that I'd read about and seen pictures of but had never experienced. But I really had no idea what I was about to encounter. Textbook pictures came to life. Plot settings became real towns and cities. Castles were real. Your castles actually exist. They're real. And if I squinted my eyes just enough, I could even see those medieval rulers and the banquets and the dancing happening. The Swiss Alps were truly the most majestic thing I have ever seen. And it was just all overwhelming. From sunup to past sundown, we were going and seeing and experiencing. And I fell into bed every night exhausted from the excitement of the day. I had no idea what to expect, and what I got was incredible. Any of you ever experienced that? Okay. So Jesus said to the crowd that day regarding John the Baptizer, "What did you go out into the wilderness to look at? What did you expect? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? Someone dressed in soft robes? Look, those who wear soft robes are in royal palaces, not out in the wilderness. What then did you go out to see? A prophet?" I have a suspicion. The people that day were just as taken aback by what they saw along the Jordan River as I was when arriving at the Amsterdam airport. I went expecting to see history and culture, but what I found was way more history and culture than the allotted 30-minute tour of each specific site allowed. There was also a whole lot more to Amsterdam than they really wanted a group of high schoolers to see. There was a lot of, "Oh, this way! Come along now!" I will say, somebody asked me after the first service, they said, "So they didn't really want you to go to the red light district." And I said, they kind of pointed at it, and we walked down like one block, but it was 10 in the morning. And so there was not much action happening. And I said, I'm pretty sure that was planned. But we were also told, do not speak to anybody. We're going from point A to point B, and we're in a time crunch and all this sort of stuff. And later, we were laughing about it, and we're like, yeah, they just didn't want to lose any students along the way in that block. Nor did they want us to pick up anything extra in that block. But there was definitely more than what I expected. It was an experience. It was educational. And the people that day went out to the river probably expecting to see a madman putting on a religious show. You remember John the Baptist earlier in scripture? He is a madman. He is kind of crazy. He's rough. He's rugged. He wears camel hair. Yuck. He smells. He eats locusts. Locusts. Bugs. He eats bugs. he was a little crazy. But what they got wasn't a madman putting on a religious show. What they got was a man announcing the advent of God's Messiah. And many were not ready for what they received. Perhaps we're still not ready. Expect the unexpected. The scene that day along the Jordan River could be described as a showcase of God's call to redemption, John the Baptist style. It was probably a pretty good show. And can't you just see the religious dignitaries' heads popping up over the people that had gathered, trying to figure out what was going on? Trying to get a glimpse of the long line of people responding to John's message and requesting baptism? I can't even fathom what that would look like. Hundreds lined up to be baptized. They went to see a showcase of Israel's popular religious culture. Instead, what they found was quite disturbing. It did not take folks long to determine it was not a sideshow. In fact, what they witnessed was life-changing. They went thinking they would find a local minister doling out religious tracts and favors. Maybe religious carnival of sorts. And what they didn't realize was they were witnessing the very forerunner to God's Messiah. John wasn't calling them to a once-in-a-lifetime experience of God's redemption and then a quiet return to the religious comfort zones. John was calling them to live redemptive lives for the rest of their life. So as we read this episode in Matthew's gospel, we too are challenged to reconsider what we expect to find when we leave the safe and acceptable confines of this room, our sanctuary on Sunday. What do we expect to find in our neighborhoods once we leave the church? Who do we anticipate will be the recipients of our ministries? Do we expect to move and work in settings that meet our expectations of the good life, where people think and act and dream like us? As Christ's disciples, do we manipulate our worlds so that we are comfortable and have all the amenities and creature comforts of American way of life? If the answer to such questions is a painful yes, which it probably is, then we seek to treat ministry as a reed shaken by the wind, or someone dressed in soft ropes, as Jesus puts it. The image here is a soft Christianity that lacks any spiritual backbone to confront injustice. Jesus' cousin was in prison because he is, one writer, William Barclay, puts it, was incapable of seeing evil without rebuking it. He had spoken too fearlessly and too definitely for his own safety. The 21st century church is being called once again to leave its safe and unthreatening confines and enter the world, to be shocked by what it finds. Our shock is to motivate us to speak truth to injustice, just as John, Jesus, and his would-be disciples did in their own day. But let's be honest. It will take disciples, not just admirers of Jesus, to do this. Matthew 11:7 is quite revealing. It says, as they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. I find this statement both disturbing and encouraging. It's disturbing because God's gospel, although it is intended for whosoever, and reality is not for everybody. I know. Call the bishop. God will not force good news upon us. We have a choice. We have a choice in the matter. God will not force good news upon us. Many left Jesus that day, perhaps because he was too demanding. They preferred a life more defined as a reed shaken by the wind or someone dressed in soft robes than a life of servitude marked by sacrifice and compassion. What John and Jesus were bringing was way too risky, too demanding. These guys were not what they expected. They preferred admirership over discipleship. Consequently, they walked away. I find the news that some walked away encouraging because we are called to discipleship by a Christ who won't dilly-dally with us. He wants us to know up front what we can expect when we follow him. To follow Christ is to speak truth to injustice and be willing to accept the consequences. To follow Christ is not just a once-in-a-lifetime experience. To follow Christ is a journey even the least among us can take. To follow Christ is to accept the evidence he has given us and then to expect the unexpected. Jesus gives us irrefutable evidence here of John's ministry, and in the process gives evidence of his own. Jesus wants us to follow him as disciples in a lifelong state of redemption. John paved the way for Jesus. He set the stage, and then he paid the price. It is not what John had expected. Being a disciple is almost never what we expect. So I invite you to expect the unexpected as we wait for the coming Christ. I invite you to a time of reflection. John and Jesus. Forgive us for being admirers and not disciples. Help us to step out of our comfort zones, outside of our religious confines, and to speak truth to injustice. To speak your glorious love into the darkness. God, help us to expect the unexpected. Help us to expect you to move where we least expect it. Help us to see the path, the way of you as we anticipate your coming yet again. It is in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
such a joy to stand up here and see each of you with us today, because we are a worshiping community. And it may be that this is your first week with us, or you may have been here lots of times, but we gather as a worshiping community and we give thanks. And as a community in Christ, we have folks among us who have joys and who have concerns, and we lift those up this morning. This morning, as a community in Christ, we lift up the joy of protection, of healing, and of new beginnings. And this morning, we especially lift up those who have experienced that, Wanda Williams and Al Ward and Elaine Detlefson, and yes, even me. We lift up those who have concerns, who are battling health concerns. And this morning, we especially lift up Ron Walton, Janet's husband, Suzanne Reschy, Marlene Clapp, Deanna Ballinger, Shirley Wenger, Diane Verville, Judy Kaufman, Carol Boyd, Amy Fulton, and Charlene and Johnny Rayburn. We ask for God's healing touch to be upon each and every one of them. Let us go to God in prayer. Creator God, it is with grateful hearts and with profound joy that we acknowledge your love and care for us. Amidst the circumstances of this earth, you send us the unexpected. You give us hope. You give us comfort. You give us healing. You give us strength and joyful hearts. Lord, you are the maker of heaven and earth. And you sent your Son to make the lame to walk, the blind to see, and the dead to find new life through your Son, Jesus Christ. We raise our voices in joy and thanksgiving for all of the many blessings, and we join together in the prayer which Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And now I invite the ushers to pass amongst us as we give back to God our offerings of joy and thanksgiving.
Give us life.
Same love that set the captives free. Same love that opened eyes to see is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide. The same God that was crucified. By name, you are. set the captives free. The same God that opened eyes to see is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that had the heavens wide, same God that was crucified, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. Calling, you're calling us to the cross. You're calling, you're calling us to the cross. You're calling, you're calling, you're calling us to the cross. You're calling, calling us to the cross. Same love that set the captives free, the same love that opened eyes to see, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. The same God that spread the heavens wide, the same God that was crucified, is calling us all by name. You are calling us all by name. You're calling, you're calling us to the cross. You're calling, you're calling us to the cross.
Your invitation to Christian discipleship is, well, to look in your bulletin. There is a whole lot of things going on. And then to offer us a little bit of grace if we got something slightly incorrect, our fearless office leader, Janet, you heard earlier, Ron is in the hospital and is expected to be there a while. So give us some grace in the next couple of weeks if we happen to misprint something or forget to do something. And thank you to our lovely office volunteers for all that you are doing and the extra help that you've been giving. We do appreciate that. So just help keep us in mind. Keep Ron and Janet and their family in prayer. Jim Prather, where are you? He's right there in the back, right there in the middle. He has in his hand little cards, look like this. They're a little bit bigger than a business card. And your invitation this week is to grab one of these cards from him and then give it to someone else. It's for our Christmas Eve services. So a neighbor or a friend or maybe even someone that we haven't seen in a while here that's a good friend. Or you can simply turn around in Walmart and say, hey, do you have anywhere to worship Christmas Eve? If not, I'd like to invite you to here, and hand them your card. And then say, I'll be at X service, and I'll look for you and sit with you. Is that stepping outside of your comfort zones? A little bit. Just a little. But it is what we are called to do this week, is expect the unexpected and go outside of those comfort zones. I want to say a word about the 5 o'clock service. That is family worship. It will be in here as our tradition. And it is a walk-in Christmas pageant. It's going to be awesome. So we might have 7 Marys, 1 Joseph, and 16 sheep. And it's not going to matter. So all kids of all ages are invited to participate. Casey's already said dibs on being a cow. I think it's because she has a cow costume already. Okay, so anyway, I digress. But if that is a little easier to put out there, I invite you to do that. So Jim has your card. Pick up your card. Make sure you grab one or five if you think you're going to be, you know, really bold this week. And that is your invitation this morning. Let us continue our worship by singing Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. The unexpected. In the name of our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, whose streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.